November 2000. National Cancer Institute, Panama City. In a series of accidents, therapy planning software created by Multidata Systems International, an American company, miscalculates the proper dosage for patients undergoing radiation therapy. The software allows a radiation therapist to draw on the screen the placement of metal shields called blocks designed to protect healthy tissue from the radiation. However, the software only allows doctors to use 4 shielding blocks, and the doctors wish to use 5. The doctors realize that they can trick the software by drawing all 5 blocks as one big block with a hole in the middle. But what the doctors don't realize is that the software gives different answers depending on which direction the hole is drawn. Draw it in one direction and the correct dose is calculated. Draw it in another direction and the software recommends twice the necessary exposure. At least 8 patients die. The doctors, who are legally obligated to double-check the computer's calculations by hand, are indicted for murder. So, let's talk about unit testing. Like most of you, the software that I write cannot kill people. But also, like most of you, people do rely on the software that I write. I rely on the software of others all the time in my daily life, and it really screws me up when the software that I rely on breaks down. Sometimes, when it breaks, it's just annoying. Sometimes, it is really, really frustrating and ruins my entire day, and sometimes it has caused me to lose work and actually made me fail at things at school or work. Your software probably doesn't control a radiation shield, but your software helps people, and helping people is important. Therefore, as programmers, we need to take the quality of our software seriously. The team that I work in does a lot of testing in many different ways, and they're all good, but I would like to spend this video talking about one specific kind of testing, unit testing. And the team I work in today does write unit tests. Unit test is part of how we work and it has worked out really well for us. However, in most teams that I've worked in, we haven't written unit tests. And the funny thing is that in those teams, most of us, or at least many of us, wanted to write unit tests, but then we didn't. What did my current unit testing team do that my former non-unit testing teams didn't do? That is what this video is about. This video is divided into 3 practical steps that I think made my team into unit testers. I will spend the entire video going into detail on each step. I will show no code, but there will be beautiful drawings. The 3 steps are: 1. Decide that commits must be unit tested. We will talk about how important it is that your team commits to one simple rule. If a commit does not have unit tests, it does not go into the repository. I will also talk about how to convince your team to commit to that. Step 2. Teach with mandatory code review. We'll talk about how you can use mandatory code review to teach each other to unit test. Step 3. Unbraid your code. In the final step, I will talk about how you can separate your code into units using 2 design patterns, injection and facades. Let's dive into step 1. Decide that commits must be unit tested. Everybody in your team needs to agree that from now on,
no commit enters the repository without that commit being covered by unit tests. Ideally, you do this at the beginning of a project. However, in practice, that almost never happens. There is simply no incentive to write unit tests at the beginning of your project. The code is so small and manageable and cute. Nobody is afraid of that code. Unit testing is a really hard sell at that point. But later, it is much easier. When your code has grown to a million lines and 400 weird edge cases and everybody is overwhelmed by regression bugs, that is the moment when you sell people on unit testing. And when you do, the sell has to be clear and simple. No commits without tests. That rule is realistic, it's easy to remember, it's unambiguous, and it allows you to work in small chunks, which allows you to squeeze it past any pointy hair. Slowly but surely, adhering to the no commits without tests rule will get you a system under test. And that is step one. Decide that commits must be unit tested. Step two, teach with mandatory code review. Unit testing is hard to do. Emotionally hard. Unit testing is like flossing your teeth. It just doesn't provide enough instant gratification to be natural to us. We have a monkey brain, and this brain is not adapted to build long-term computer architecture. This brain is adapted for the quick acquisition of... Therefore, we need a structure to hold ourselves accountable. And that structure, my friends, is mandatory code reviews. Mandatory code reviews will do wonders for your code quality. The list of benefits of mandatory code review is really long, but there are many other talks and books and stuff about that, so I'm going to focus on one of them. You can use mandatory code review to stay committed to unit testing. And that is because mandatory code review allows you to start using one simple, sneaky, but extremely effective trick. When you are reviewing code and you are a little bit uncertain if the tests are actually any good, you can simply mess things up a little bit in the code and see if the tests do break. And if they don't, like they should, then you just comment on the commit saying, hey, this code looks nice, but I could delete this entire line and the tests still pass. Could you make sure that that is covered by the test as well? That is very good, actionable feedback, and it's a really good way of teaching developers unfamiliar with unit testing how to get into it. That's step two. Teach with mandatory code review. Step three. Unbraid your code. As soon as your team starts writing unit tests for an existing code base, you will all run into a wall. A huge f***ing brick wall. And it's going to sound something like this. But this code is too complex to unit test. Do not panic. This is normal. It happens to everyone. The word complex is Latin, and it means braided, jumbled together. Complex is the opposite of another Latin word called simplex, which means separate, or side by side, or units. Do you get it? When you're saying that your code is too complex, you're actually saying that it is not in units. And not unsurprisingly, your code needs to be in units in order for you to unit test it. Fortunately for us, there are well-documented and battle-tested design patterns to help us break braided code into units. We are going to talk about two of them, injection and facades. I'll begin with injection. I'm going to describe a problem, and then I'm going to show you how to solve it using injection. Let's imagine that we have a system that does orders and payments. We have discovered that our system crashes if the bank is down. We want to fix this by displaying a could not connect to your bank message so that our customers get annoyed with their shitty bank instead of with us. We also want to write a unit test so that this bug does not rear its ugly head again. So imagine that our system looks like this. It has an order thing. Let's say that we call createOrder on the order thing. As a result of calling createOrder, the order thing will, inside itself, instantiate a pay thing, like this. The order thing will then call pay on the pay thing instance, like this, which in turn sends the payment request to the bank, like this. Now we want to write a unit test that simulates the bank returning an error. One good way of solving this would be a fake pay thing, a mock pay thing, which in turn returns a mock error. The problem is that we cannot do this in this architecture, because pay thing is created inside the order thing. Any unit test that we would write would have no way of getting its mock pay thing into the order thing. And this is an example of braided code. There is a unit that we want to test, order thing, but it is braided together with pay thing, and that prevents us from testing the order thing separately. We cannot write unit tests for the order thing because it is not a unit. It's actually two units braided together. Well, instead of instantiating pay thing inside of order thing, we instantiate it outside and inject pay thing into order thing, like this. The order thing is no longer responsible for creating a payment thing. Instead, it now expects to be passed a pay thing that has been created outside. The real code will use the real injected pay thing, while the unit tests instead inject a mock pay thing, like this. Now, when we are writing our unit test, we can simply tell the mock pay thing to throw an error when pay is called on it, like this. By injecting pay thing into order thing, instead of having order thing create pay thing inside of itself, we have unbraided the two, allowing us to test them as separate units. And that is the injection pattern. We are now going to look at another problem, and I am going to show you how to solve it using a facade. Now, imagine a similar scenario where you have a pay thing and you have an order thing, but the pay thing, that's not your code. It's a third-party component that the payment company provides. And now imagine that the pay thing API looks like this. To make a payment, you start by passing the bank API endpoint URI to the connect method. And the API endpoint, that's the same every time. That will return a new object, a connection object, which you in turn will call pay on. The pay method wants a protection eligibility, which is, you know, some legacy parameter that should always be set to true. And it also wants an amount. That, in turn, yields a response object, which has a property called isSuccess. This is not the best API. It's not the worst API. It's pretty easy to call. But I now want you to pause this video and imagine mocking this API. Have you paused yet? You should. I'm waiting. Pause. Did you pause? Of course you did. No, you didn't. Let's have a look. You'd have to first create the mock response object here at the bottom. Then you create a mock connection object in the middle with a pay method that will return the mock response. And finally, create a mock pay thing with a connect method that returns the mock connection object when connect is called. That is not rocket surgery, but it is very cumbersome, and you would be repeating that code that mocking dance for every test. And that is very annoying because we're not testing the pay thing here, we're testing the ordered thing. And those tests are only interested in one thing, that the correct amount is passed to the pay thing. An effective way to deal with this is to simply encapsulate the whole API behind a facade. To simplify and flatten it, like this. What we have done here is to wrap the entire pay thing inside a payment facade. And the facade has a much simpler interface, just has a single pay method. In this new refactored world, instead of passing in the pay thing directly into the order thing, we just pass in the facade, like this. Now, when writing a test, we just mock payment facade, instead of mocking pay thing, like this. If we were mocking the pay thing directly, every test would need to do a bunch of stuff to mock the payment, creating that connection object and so on, but the payment facade API is flat and stupid, so the only call that the test need to mock is the pay call. In this video, we've talked about how to get your team to start unit testing. We have talked about three simple things that you can do. Decide that commits must be unit tested. Teach with mandatory code review and unbraid your code using injection and facades. You have just watched an episode of FunFunFunction. This is a weekly show where we try to become more excited and confident about programming by exploring old wisdom, wild ideas, and having fun. I'm the one doing the talking here, but the show is shaped by you. Please comment down below and tell me who you are and how you want to improve as a programmer. Finally, and most importantly, make sure that you don't miss the next episode of FunFunFunction. Subscribe to the channel or follow me on Twitter at mpjme. Until next Monday, stay curious.